tonight on Chronicle. We go inside Greenville's Children's Hospital.
Yeah, this can be a really, really happy place, and it can be a very sad place, too.
A place where miracles happen every day.
This is just a little bump in the road, and I still have mountains to go over in my life.
The most helpless patients in the greatest need.
I never cry when they do that. I get used to it.
We didn't know what type of cancer it was, what type of anything it was.
The people dedicated to giving these children hope.
Can you smile?
I think they perform miracles in this hospital.
Tonight on Chronicle, where miracles happen. And now your host, Jane Robolo.
Hello and welcome to Chronicle. This may look like any hospital to you, but this place is different. This place is special because of the patients who come here and the people who treat them. We're in the Children's Hospital of the Greenville Hospital System University Medical Center. Here you'll find the youngest of the young, often in the greatest of need. Some are born premature, needing help just to breathe. Some are racked by illness that should not come into the life of one so young. Some have chronic conditions that require surgery and rehabilitation. We recently spent a week in the Children's Hospital. Over the next hour, you'll see what we found and why many feel this is a place where miracles happen every day. Life on the floor of the Children's Hospital often doesn't feel like life in a hospital at all. Apart from all of the medicine and other modern science, the power of human touch heals in its own way. So that's where we begin. As our Michael Cogdell found out, this is a place where hard times mingle with human beings at their weakest point, their strongest, and their best.
Every bit as reliable as the rise of dawn. They wake to a new day.
Morning, Miss Heather.
And work it together.
Are you still sleeping under there?
Science, hope, and love. Take their quiet steps around here, trying to make children well.
My son was born without an esophagus.
And somehow managed to fill a hospital with a feeling of home.
He's had 92 surgeries and he's only 2.5.
He picked his shades out of the prize drawer.
You ready to put them on?
Lighting up this floor so well.
I told Jonathan, every time he go in the prize drawer, he picked two things out. He always have to have both hands full.
Jonathan's mom, Tiffany, might need those shades.
We're cool, huh?
At home away from home, I mean, they make you feel as comfortable as they can while you're here.
It's just scary to me. There's really no words for it. I hated when we first got here and they hooked up all the needles to her and it terrified me to death.
When the patients show up this size, 3 months old, with a lung disease, cystic fibrosis.
We've been here for approximately 2 weeks.
Feeling the comforts of home can get as simple as how Emily and her mom Alicia get around.
Give them a big smile.
We're a lot better now.
And if courage and faith left their tracks around here,
the hardest part of this was accepting that I had it.
The footprints just might lead straight to William Lopez.
I don't really care if they have to take my leg or if it takes me away, but whatever God's plan is, honestly, you know?
Man-sized faith from a 14-year-old whose leg contains Ewing sarcoma. It's a kind of bone cancer. Neither chemo, nor radiation, nor cancer has managed to match his teenage determination.
This is just a little bump in the road, and I still have mountains to go over in my life. That's the way I see it.
He's my hero, seriously. He keeps me going.
And the machines keep going, dripping drugs into his blood and helping William's mother, Michelle, learn things about her son and herself.
It's like you either keep going ahead weak or strong, so you just gotta go strong through this, you know, because this. Honestly, we feel there's no other way to do it.
They all do it together.
They're my other children away from home.
The halls of this hospital have a way of wearing the tracks of one big family.
So I love my kids here and I love them at home. So I do the best I can to take care of them and make sure they get what they need.
For a staff working to heal bodies and raise spirits.
We got awesome patients here.
There's no payment quite like a smile.
For example.
William or Lucy, just down the hall.
We got here about a week and a half ago.
Lucy Hicks is 7.
Just cut the top off.
Cut the top off for you.
Flew in here from the North Carolina coast with a blood disorder.
We've got the doctors coming in, and they'll tell us whether she gets to go home or not today.
Her room had to start feeling like home for everybody who cared for her. Kenneth, her dad, will tell you.
And after 2 weeks in the hospital, hair and shaving aren't all what they're cracked up to be.
So you ready to get out of here today? Yeah. Get you home.
And we're cheering for football. I thought we were going to cheer for baseball or something.
And yet through it all, the young...
You going to give them some smiles?
...who show up here unwell have a way of seeing life through a lens tinged with hope. And like Farah, a 3-year-old with leukemia.
Ooh! Can you smile?
They tend to make tracks to feel it right at home.
What a smile. You're such a ham.
And that smile is just what the people who work here hope to see in their young patients. Changing lives and having dreams fulfilled, that's part of the legacy of the Children's Hospital. Michael Cogdell now with the story of a young woman with a big dream. Without this hospital, the dream dies. But thanks to what happened here, she's living large along the footlights.
That's right. You said that you love yellow.
If they painted portraits of recovery at the Children's Hospital...
I had surgery one time.
Did it hurt?
Of course it didn't hurt. I didn't feel it.
Some of the faces might surprise you. Laura Scott at 18 shows the world a face that defies that scar on the back of her head.
I don't want to cry, but it was crazy. I was so scared.
Hey.
Hey.
How are you?
I'm good.
Hard to believe. Laura was born with Chiari malformation.
It was really bad. I haven't had a headache like that in a really long time.
And part of her brain protruding through the base of her skull.
She wants to dance every day.
For a girl who started dancing when she was 4, it threatened her entire body and her dream.
I've wanted to be a Radio City Rockette since I was 10 years old.
There's no dance career when your head hurts so much.
Booming.
Nearly every thought.
Stabbing.
Seems to thunder like the 4th of July.
Fireworks in the back of my head. When I sneezed, laughed, cried, especially danced, I would drop to my knees in pain.
This is an MRI of her brain.
So at 17, knowing Chiari could paralyze her,
that's the line at the base of the skull,
Laura went under the knife of pediatric neurosurgeon Dr. Chris True.
And then here's where we did the surgery.
He cut through muscle, worked in her spine, one wrong move, and Laura and her mom knew she might never stand to dance again.
The only option we had was surgery. Didn't have another option.
I just prayed for God's will to be done because I knew whatever God's will was what was right for me. If it was right for me to never wake up, I knew that that's what God wanted.
Tell it!
The surgery worked. The dancer came back.
If we had not gotten her out of pain, then her dream would have been taken from her.
Fireworks in her head in a finale. With the pain in her head quieting, Laura's traded in the hallways of a children's hospital for a theater in the capital city, Columbia, where on a night not long before the 4th of July, she had a date with the stage, trying to win that head a crown. Watch me as I dance, and love is my life.
88 of the most beautiful, talented, brilliant young women from across South Carolina.
The Miss South Carolina pageant actually lasts about a week.
Laura Scott, 18, in Simpsonville.
She's gonna set those tap shoes on fire, and I can't wait to see her. I'm very excited about it.
In Simpsonville, Laura Scott.
In the prelims, Laura won a talent competition.
Woo! You go, girl!
The evening gown winner tonight, Miss Simpsonville, Laura Scott.
Then evening gown.
I'm so proud right now because she's come so far. And you know, I can't ask her any more than right now.
But on the pageant's big Saturday night.
Our first contestant is Miss Laura Scott Simpsonville.
Mom Nikki knew her little girl had had to lie down backstage with an ice pack.
I think it strengthens her because there's perseverance that you would not believe in that kid.
Through pain lingering from the surgery, with Dr. Troop in the crowd,
what would you change about our state?
Laura made the top 10 anyway.
I definitely excel in the arts.
She slid through, so I'm just like on pins and needles.
The needle sharpened when this patient from the Children's Hospital slid into the top 5.
That's my baby!
You're going to have to call 911 because I will pass out in the floor.
It's greater than that.
Mom might have passed out had Laura made the final 2. But when they cheered the winner, she stood nearby, 4th runner-up.
I was so happy because he saved my life.
And within minutes, the arms of a pediatric brain surgeon beat the daylights out of any crowd.
I was proud of her before she ever walked on the stage, just because of who she is. But I'm so proud for her. She's done a great job. She's represented herself so well.
But I've been through something really hard, and I'm just really happy to be here.
What she's been through makes any pageant look easy.
Oh, how cool is that? A dinosaur.
And her into the face of a children's hospital success story.
Well, I'm glad you're doing well.
Thank you.
Okay.
Co-written by a brain surgeon.
It's what makes you want to wake up every day and do what you do.
You made the fireworks go out.
I just want to leave my legacy and my mark. Not on South Carolina, but the world.
Now we're in a place that many feel is the very heart of the Children's Hospital, the neonatal intensive care unit. Here, babies who come into the world far too soon or with serious problems can get the life-saving care they need.
Emotions that I can think of are just fear.
Enter a different world.
There's nothing that anybody can tell you to prepare you for.
A place that asks for quiet.
When you walk into the NICU, it's a very overwhelming place.
Amid the sounds of machines that keep the tiniest patients alive.
There's lots of alarms, monitors, and tubes, and just to see that on your baby, it's really scary.
So how are you doing today, Jackson?
But after 54 days here, the fear finally fades for the Carver family.
Whoa! Where are you going, big boy?
Baby Jackson, born at just 2 pounds, 8 ounces, is thriving. To go home, he'll have to take all his bottles, hold his temperature outside the isolette, and breathe on his own, which he's doing.
The doctor said he'll be fine. He just needs to be on a little bit of breather.
But for other families, the neonatal intensive care experience just started.
They've been taking good care of him, which I appreciate a lot.
Jamie Isaac came early, too early.
I was a little worried, but they told me that the only thing that was wrong was that his lungs were premature.
Little Jamie is being treated in the biggest neonatal intensive care unit in South Carolina. There are 80 beds here. A neonatologist cares for these babies.
It's just the love for the job that keeps you coming back day after day.
But much of the care comes from the NICU nurses, people like Andy Walters, who has a special empathy for these babies.
I was a patient here in the Bryan Neonatal Intensive Care Unit back in 1981. I was born 11 weeks premature, weighed 2 pounds, 10 ounces, and I today work with the same nurses that took care of me, doctors and nurses.
It's a special call for nurses drawn to care for the tiniest, often most fragile patients. Dana Beatty's son was a NICU baby 15 years ago.
But it was literally sitting here those 4 months that I fell in love with not just nursing, but NICU nursing, and this was the only thing I ever wanted to do.
The NICU treats about 750 babies a year. Most survive, but some don't.
So this is a way to provide them with some comfort, give them things that they will remember their baby by.
This family support room, staffed by the March of Dimes, offers families who've lost a child angel gowns and memory boxes to be filled with pictures, casts of hands and feet, anything that touched the baby.
It's a real privilege to be able to provide that type of comfort to a family. We can't change some of the situations that happen, but we can really work hard to make sure that the family feels supported and is comforted, and that their child is respected and honored.
Jackson, I drew a picture for you.
But 98% of the babies who come through here do survive and thrive. For those who care for them so intensely, it's wonderful to see these babies leave this nest.
That's just like you do when your kids grow up, but this is a good start for them. They get to go home and live life with their family, which is what they're meant to do.
I love you, Jackson.
And it's a special day when these young patients get to finally take that trip home with their families.
Still to come on Chronicle, where miracles happen.
I get used to it.
The power of a positive attitude.
Who is it?
A beta.
1, 2, 3, courage!
And a refuge for children who need a place to call their own.
Seen so many parents that have been just thrilled at having their babies survive and make it.
Where are you, sister?
We now return to Chronicle, where miracles happen.
Children who are unwell have a way of bringing out the best in the adults around them. They inspire us. And when we introduce you to a child that Michael Cogdill met, you may never see your life the same way again.
I think I had Cheerios. You had Cheerios? Ice cream, something good. Sounds like a watermelon. It's ripe.
Dr. Carrie Stroud might find a fire in that belly for something.
Get his port stuck and start his medicine.
It's a long way from the medical stuff.
Chemo.
Let's put that on the bottom.
Really long way from Candyland.
The popsicle.
Through hours of treatment, Lee Earl Jackson III plays this game and dreams of one that men never master.
Yeah, this is just every day to him now. This is just part of his routine, so.
No counting or counting?
No counting.
All right. Good job.
Dad and Mom have watched their 5-year-old come through a chemotherapy routine like a man.
I never cry when they do that. I get used to it.
He never cries.
Mr. Lee Earl Jackson is a fine young fella. He has a brain tumor that he's on treatment for now. He seems to be responding.
Right there and right there.
He's responded before surgery, removed most of that brain tumor, but it came back.
You're gaining on me now.
It's, be quite honest, almost the worst news you can have, because you think of a death sentence. You don't know the options that are out there to fight this thing.
But children have a way of getting second chances. Doctors find cancer is more treatable in them than in adults.
They are strong. I mean, they can, they're very adaptable. You know, children go through a lot of things we wish they didn't have to go through, but they're tough physically and emotionally.
And this one is gifted. Lee Earl Jackson is a bit of a YouTube golf sensation. Just watch and remember, he's 5.
Wow.
Even in the chemo treatment room, we found him training to be a macho man. This kind of living is what the Children's Hospital staff is all about.
You have been working out.
Everybody takes it seriously, and yet they don't take themselves too seriously.
A bit more, he's grown some, so he'll get 0.9 milligrams.
In this grown-up world around here, a little boy with a big guy's golf swing.
I think I see a French fry right down there.
And actually fight a brain tumor better than a man.
And then you see his spirit and attitude and prayers. It really helps out an awful lot.
Spirit and attitude clearly live in the heart of Lee Earl Jackson. Children are not miniature adults, and nowhere is that more obvious than in a busy ER, where the sights and the sounds can be decidedly adult only. Well, that's one of the reasons why the Children's Hospital has this, Children's Emergency Center, where a child is a child.
Kind of shocking, you know, I mean, just kind of scared.
I'm going to move your hair out of the way.
It's been a rough day for 2-year-old Morgan Skipper.
It might be a little cold because I keep it in my refrigerator.
She fell off the ottoman, just a little accident playing with brother.
Okay. Now I'm going to get your headband going.
Morgan has a head wound. A few doors down, 6-year-old Hayden Greenleaf has been vomiting for 2 days. He's exhausted.
We've now found out that he's going to have surgery.
But both children and parents find support here.
They're taken care of by people who are specially trained to take care of kids.
Everything about this emergency center is child-friendly.
It says kids have a safe place to come.
From the artwork to the attire worn by the doctors.
We did not have the pediatric emergency room. The kids would be treated in and amongst the adult patients, which means that they would probably see and hear things that were not very child-friendly.
And it's a busy place.
I started rolling to the back of his head.
26,000 visits are made here every year.
We would like to see it get even smaller than that, but people will bypass the emergency rooms all over to come be treated in a pediatric facility.
It broke.
That's what the family of 6-year-old Dallas Weathers did when he wrecked his bike.
I dumped on the hill, and he wrecked.
He hit a hole and he fell off.
And it cried nothing.
And it hurt his elbow.
The Children's Emergency Center at the Children's Hospital is a level 1 trauma center for upstate South Carolina, western North Carolina, and northeastern Georgia.
Not all hospitals are level 1 trauma facilities. They don't have the services available. We are lucky that, you know, we have x-ray, we have CAT scan, we have an operating room that are open and available to children 24 hours a day.
Good job.
Dallas gets an x-ray. His adventure on his bike led to a broken elbow. Treatment for Morgan may seem uncommon. Her head wound is serious enough to be stapled shut.
Squeeze.
Some support.
Great job.
Some distraction.
Push him one more time, and then we're done, okay?
Some coping skills.
Awesome.
Good job.
And it's done.
We're done.
Another child,
great.
Treated like a child,
bye.
And released.
The medical director of the Children's Hospital, Dr. Bill Schmidt, credits Greenville pediatrician Dane Pierce with keeping the dream of having a children's ER in the Children's Hospital.
Ahead on Chronicle, when miracles happen.
His name's Toby.
How special visitors let these children be children.
It's just the love of the dog.
We began this program highlighting the humanity of the Children's Hospital, but this place runs on more than doctors and nurses. Volunteers form a lifeblood all their own. And flowing through these halls, we found some volunteers who managed to heal without advanced degrees. They don't even wear shoes. Certainly, they don't speak a language that we fully understand. And yet, as Michael Cogdell found out, they are a comfort well beyond words.
She has the kind of face that might launch 1,000 wags.
High five.
High five, Chase.
Good boy, Chase.
But this story begins with a 3-legged dog.
He has not a clue he has any problems at all.
Chase lost his leg to abuse when he was just a pup.
His legacy is everybody loves him.
But come Wednesday afternoons, when the pet therapists come here again,
and he gets to visit the people he loves,
Chase carries himself really well.
He just thinks that's the way it's supposed to be, and that other dogs with 4 legs are the weird ones.
Okay.
You just want to pet him?
And in the healing business, this is more than child's play.
And it's that moment of, all I have to do is pet this dog for 5 minutes, and that's all that matters. And that is just really healing to everybody in the room.
Emily Durham, the child life supervisor, says science can measure how a dog can lower blood pressure, heart rate, even the stress hormone cortisol.
His name's Toby.
A face like Toby's has even been known to heal a heartbroken staff.
The staff gets such a relief out of seeing the dogs. Their cortisol levels go down, their stress levels go down.
Speak.
Good job.
And on this Wednesday, an old friend will say goodbye.
His name's Boomer.
Boomer retires after today.
He just got old.
After years of comforting ill children, he has fallen ill.
He's having trouble breathing. And
what was that?
And remember this face? That's Rebecca, who's not much for petting dogs with her hands. But a good old boy like Boomer doesn't mind some love on foot.
Good girl, Rebecca.
His owner, Jackie, needs not a word to say how that goodbye is going to feel.
I knew this was going to happen.
That dogs aren't like pets, they're a family, pretty much.
Yeah.
You're right. They don't read charts, never ask for an insurance card.
Yeah, there you go.
A dog, even the three-legged and the mighty old, can simply walk a hallway and let love out to run.
It's just the love of a dog.
Linda and Chase did more than 150 visits last year, and she said Chase never has a bad day. He never has a grumpy day and helps children forget that they're in the hospital. That's a pretty great legacy for any volunteer. For better or worse, life changes fast here at the Children's Hospital. What happens here can alter families' lives forever. We gathered the material you've seen in this Chronicle a few weeks ago, and we already have some updates to share. So before we say goodbye, we thought you'd want some answers to the question, where are they now? Here again, Michael Cogdill and Carol Goldsmith.
Laura Scott keeps working toward her dream of dancing in New York City. She's modeling for Abercrombie & Fitch, saving her money for a move to New York in January. As she interns at Broadway Dance Center, she'll think about competing in another pageant, she says, but it all depends on how the dance career goes. Laura's not only a survivor of Chiari malformation, she is thriving.
You want to try it on?
Yeah.
Okay.
Samantha Loftus enjoys many activities that were unthinkable until her surgery. She's jogging, taking dance lessons, playing the violin and viola. For the next 3 years, while a bar holds her rib cage in place, she won't be able to tumble or twist. But her mom says the surgery helped her confidence. Samantha says the only time she knows the bar is there is when she sneezes.
I bring people close to God.
Lee Earl Jackson III keeps fighting cancer in his own heroic way. He developed an allergy to the chemo. It's made him a little too tired for the driving range lately, but Lee Earl is back in school, and his dad tells us he's doing well with about a year's worth of chemotherapy ahead.
C as in Cole.
Cole Carroll continues to reach out to the world around him.
Great job, Cole.
His best buddy is his brother Ethan. Cole can get by now with not using his ventilator during the day. He only needs its help when he's asleep or not feeling well. Cole's sunny, energetic nature remains the same.
Those are the young people we met during our brief week here. And we know that not every story has a happy outcome. But what we also know is that before this place and other hospitals like it came into being, the chances for happy outcomes weren't nearly as good. Now, families are finding hope. Lives are being changed. Thank you for joining us for Chronicle, where miracles happen. I'm Jane Robillot. Goodbye.